everybody, and welcome to the fourth episode of 007, A Bondiful Year. I'm so excited to be back because I'm always excited when I actually get to talk about a James Bond movie that I had never seen before that I am actually seeing for the first time to give a review to you. And that, of course, is the 1965 film Thunderball, which of course returns Sean Connery to the big screen and gives us another great story of MI6 versus Spectre. And this time around, I have to say that one of the best things is we're finally starting to see the layers being pulled back on Spectre. We got a little bit of a taste of them in Dr. No and from Russia with Love, but this time we really start to see a whole lot more of the inner workings, especially with the shadowy figure that seems to be the head of the entire operation, as well as another one of the leading villains in the group, who also has one of those distinct looks for James Bond villainy, and that, of course, is the character Largo, who is played by Adolfo Celli. So, in this movie, James Bond finds out that somewhere in the Caribbean, Spectre has stolen two nuclear warheads, and they are planning to use them on the world, and of course, they are going to be holding the world for ransom. So of course, it is up to everybody's favorite super spy, 007, once again played by Sean Connery, to take them down. So he goes into the Caribbean, he teams up with one of the other most well-known leading ladies, who is Claudine Auger, who plays the character Domino. Also, Felix Leiter returns, and once again, I'm excited for this one because we had such a great film with Goldfinger, so I was really curious to see where Thunderball was going to lead me. I gotta say, there's definitely a lot of good things to say about Thunderball, but it's definitely not one of the better films in the James Bond collection. I mean, once again, we get the straight-up formula. We also get the great introduction song, this time done by the powerhouse that he is, Tom Jones, singing Thunderball. It's such a great song. Probably also one of the better songs in the James Bond collection. We also see the rest of the usual formula, which I actually forgot to mention in the Goldfinger review, because now we are seeing a true trend setting in these films, because we see Bernard Lee returning as M, Lois Maxwell returning as Miss Moneypenny, and of course Desmond Lewin playing Q, who in Goldfinger gave us the first time when he actually showed James Bond all of the gadgets that he was going to take on his trip and how they work. And of course, knowing how James Bond movies usually end up, we all know where it's gonna go. But one of the more interesting things about this film was the fact that it actually had the biggest budget to date, and it was also a huge portion filmed underwater. There's a great deal of the use of water in this film, and even at the very end, there is a monstrous action sequence where James Bond is actually fighting Spectre's henchmen underwater. And it is definitely a fun film. We definitely see Sean Connery's charm, as there are so many great jokes in this film. I also really did appreciate the villain. He definitely was one of the strong silent types, not as much of an action taker like Goldfinger was, but still a true threat, and knowing that he was, in this case, dare I say it, the number two to the head of Spectre's. You see where I'm going with that, all you Austin Powers fans out there? I still feel that he was a great force to be reckoned with, because he did look rather menacing. I also did appreciate Domino. I thought she definitely had some grit to her, and it's great to see more strong females in the world of James Bond. But even though we have a true strong first and second act, it's the third act that really takes a dive, literally, because almost the entire ending of that film is filmed underwater. And while it was amazing to actually see the camera work and the cinematography and all of the special effects that were used to make these underwater fight sequences work, it just moves ultra slow. You feel like you just finished a 10-mile marathon and you are just ready to plot, because that end sequence is just so freaking exhausting. But where are we left? Well, one of the things that I can certainly say is, even though this is not one of the stronger Bond films, we are definitely excited for the next adventure ahead. It's definitely one of those James Bond films that I would gladly show people. I mean, granted, I'll show all the James Bond films to people who have never seen a James Bond movie before, and I definitely think that there are many people that would appreciate this movie, there are people that would not appreciate this movie, and there are people like myself that would fall in between, but there still is a great deal of things to enjoy in this movie, which is why I still feel that it is stronger than some of the other Bond films, which is why I will give it a 3 stars out of 4, because overall, minus the last sequence in the film, I truly did enjoy it. So that is my review for Thunderball, everybody. I'm so happy that I'm doing this segment because it just feels so great to finally watch all of these James Bond films, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say about Thunderball in the comments below, and I will see you in the next episode. Hey, thank you so much for stopping by my channel today. If you're new here and want to see more of what my channel has to offer, please click on the link to my last video, or hit that subscribe button to be kept up to date with all of my uploads. Content of all sorts is posted here quite often, so trust me, you do not want to fall behind. I will see you in the comments, and actions speak louder than words.